Okay, so we have gone in the week five, we want to cover dynamic behavior of the second order and higher. Okay, previously in the previous week, we covered the dynamic behavior of the first order systems. Now we go with the second order and higher systems. We went a bit faster in the last in the last week that we already covered basically half of the week five material, so we will continue in here, and if possible today we will also continue to take the to go into the week six materials as well, and then I probably will open up the process control lecture for this week for a consultation either on your project one for process control or project one for the process modeling. So probably we will not have a lecture sessions for tomorrow, but rather we will open it up for the consultation session for your project one, either in process control or process modeling. You are free to ask anything that you want to ask. Of course not. I will not answer your project one for process modeling, or I will not answer some of your project one questions for your process control. But if there is anything that you want to ask regarding the project one, in case you have any doubts, anything, then happy to be consulted on that. Okay, so I'll try to finish the last half of the week five materials today, and then also go into the other materials for the week six. Okay, I think we can cover it very very quickly, because it's not going to be a difficult concept on this one. Okay, so we have gone through this characteristic of an underdamped response, right? And we show you what does this mean with the underdamped response. We can measure we have some terms that comes with this characteristic of the underdamped response, which is the overshoot decay ratio, period of oscillation, time to first peak response time or rise time. And those, we show that can be calculated from your damping coefficient. Okay, this is the formula for the overshoot. There is a formula for the decay ratio. There is a formula for the period of oscillation. There is a formula for the time to first peak, and there is a formula for the response time as well. Okay, so let's go to the second example. If you are given the following transfer function, we know that this is a second order system. Okay, in the denominator in here, we know that the S is being raised to the order of 2. So we want to overview how we determine the overshoot decay ratio, period of oscillation, time to first peak, and response time. So we first express the transfer function in the standard form, okay, and multiply by the step input. So the step input in here is basically the disturbance that we do into our system, because our system in here is a second order system in here. Okay, if we do something like this, then we want to make it into the standard form. So the standard form in here is something like this. Okay, we want to make it such that we have this in the denominator. We have for the second order term, we have it's finished with one at the end. Okay, so what we did in here is we make it in a form like this, by dividing the numerator with 4 and dividing the denominator with 4. Once we get this, then we can match it with the standard form for the second order transfer function. Then we can find out the time constant. Time constant will be the root square of 3.75. And then likewise, we can find in the damping coefficient. The damping coefficient is 0.31. Therefore, by doing these things, we can find that the overshoot will be equal to this, the decay ratio will be equal to this, the period of oscillation will be equal to 12.795, time to the first peak 6.397, the response time will be equal to 3.3. 84. And the other thing that we can measure also is the inverse of the cos. Okay, that will be the angle. The angle, which is 1.256. Okay, this comes from your from this things in here. Okay. So if we look back again after the example, this one should come as straightforward for everybody, right? This is just a plug-in of the formula. I think you can do these things very easily. You just need to be sure that you match the form correctly, and then don't forget also to find out to determine what is your time constant and what is your damping coefficient. So the remarks in here is that the first order system that we have discussed last week, we have a capacity and we have a resistance. Okay, that will be something that comes up with the nature. And we also have something like a pure capacitive or purely integrator. If we have such systems, meaning we have a capacity but we don't have a resistance. Okay, this pure capacitive or purely integrator system is not really common in nature. Okay. The first order system, and then the second order system is in essence is just the mass or energy flows through a series of two capacitor systems, and they can be non-interacting system or they can be an interacting system. Okay, so these are the example. If there are non-interacting capacities, then you put in the first tank. The outlet from the first tank will go into the second tank. Okay. The tank 1 fits tank 2 and thus affects its dynamic behavior. However, tank 2 does not affect the dynamic behavior of tank 1. We have something that is interacting. So if you put in the two tanks in the equal level, such that the outlet from the first tank is determined by the height of the liquid in the tank 2, that means they have interaction between each other, because the flow rate F1 will depend on the difference between the liquid levels H1 and H2. Okay, so let's consider the tank shown in figure 10. So this we are talking about the second order system due to controllers. Okay, this is just one tank, but we intend to control the liquid level at the desired value when the inlet flow rate undergoes step change. In this case, we are putting in a proportional integral controller. So this is how we model the tank. We start firstly with the mass balance, okay, which is at the steady state is like this, okay. We have three variables in here that may change, okay. So if we subtract this with the second one, we have this one. Okay, we have these deviation variables. The error is used by the controller to increase or decrease the effluent flow rate according to this relationship. The first term in here corresponds to the proportional controller. The second term in here corresponds to the integral part of your controller. So, when we're talking about the proportional, the magnitude of the corrections, okay, in here, we basically use this F naught. F naught is the outlet to control the liquid level. Okay, the error will be proportional to the deviations from the steady state for the proportional. But for the integral part of this thing, it takes an integration of the deviations from the steady state in terms of the liquid height of the tank. Okay, from 0 to t. Okay, it multiplied by the kc divided by the time constant of the integral. So when we have in this integral, our steady state value of whatever we control should come back to the original steady state value. If we insert this equation 2 into equation 1, we will have these equations in here. And we can rearrange. We move this term into the left-hand side. Okay, we move this term into the left-hand side as well. Then we take Laplace transform. It may look a bit complicated if we don't take a Laplace transform. So the point of we using a Laplace transform is we can make it much easier. Or if we take a Laplace transform, we will have this. Okay, we know that the Laplace transform of this is equal to dH per dt is equal to this. Okay, and then we have this, and then we have this one as well. Okay, we may want to check the table again on how this can become this, the form can become this. You want to go in back into your Laplace transform again, which we will not be covering in here. Okay, once we get these things, we continue the derivations, and guys, you can check this derivation and see whether there is anything that is wrong. Okay, once you get these things, then you know that you have a transfer function that has a second order in the denominator in here. Now you can compare it with the standard form of the second order transfer function. Then we can we can find in some kind of a formula to connect or to extract the time constant and the damping coefficients and also the proportional gain in here. Okay, then we can get this particular two terms. So we know that basically we have many other possibility. We have three different possibilities of the second order system. They can arise if we have two first order system that non-interacting, okay, such as this liquid storage tank, where the first tank affecting the second tank, but the second tank does not affect the first tank. Okay, and then we have something with the interacting capacities as well, where the second tank, there is a dynamic that affect between both tanks. And then we have second order system that arise due to the controller. When we install a controller, then we know that we can what we have is eventually the second order system as well. Okay, then in here, if we go deeper again to the second order system due to controllers, we know that depending on the values of the damping coefficients and the time constant, you can have the three different cases again: the underdamped response, the critically damped response, or the overdamped response. Okay, then if you go back into this this figure, this will be showing you what do we mean by the underdamped, overdamped, and the critically damped response. This one is the one that shows you. We go to slides number 6. So if we do some kind of summary, this second order behavior is, if we have no control, we will have this curve in here that goes into a new liquid level. Okay, if we take the damping coefficient as less than 1, we will have this behavior. If we have higher than 1, we will have this behavior. If we have equal to 1, we will have this behavior. Okay. Same with the second order system. The higher order system may arise due to the several different cases, such as n first order processes in series, processes with that time, and the processes with inverse response. So the processes with that time is the one that we don't really cover in here, but what we call is basically a delay, a time delay. That one is covered in your project one as for your temperature measurement. For two capacities in series, interacting or non-interacting, give rise to second order system. For n capacities that are non-interacting, the overall transfer function is this. Okay. For n on non-interacting capacities in series, the response has the characteristics of generally an overdamped system, S-shaped and sluggish. Increasing the number of capacities in series will increase the sluggishness of the response. Sluggishness meaning it will make it very slow. Slow to respond. Interaction also will increase the sluggishness of the overall response. This is why I like I told you again in the plant wide process control, why essentially the theory and the Laplace transform can only describe a very ideal ideal systems, because in the real process, if you have, like, for example, a reactor that interacted with the distillation column, or a reactor that interacted with the absorption column, or distillation column that interacted with the other distillation column, or when you put in a recycling system, then it will be quite complicated. You cannot just use a linear ODE to capture the behavior of the whole process. Okay, that's why you need to go and do the simulation, like an Aspen Plus simulations, to help you to be able to simulate the behavior of the system. These are what is meant by the processes with time delay. So we assume that there is an instant, there is not that time between the input and the output. Okay, this is not true, because if a step change introduced in the input, then you will only be able to, you cannot instantaneously measure the response in here. So the output will only be obtained after a time delay of TD. Because there are a time that is needed from this one to go into this particular point. A flow need a time for you to be felt in this particular point. That's why you have a time delay. Okay, this can be explained by this figure in here. If you take in the time domain, which is the one shown in the upper diagram in here, okay, you put in an FT, you have a YT, and then with the dead time, you will put in T minus TD, the output. If we use the Laplace transform, then this is what we will get. For example, we have a KP, TPS divided by TPS plus 1. Then what you did in here is you need to operate with this one, exponential minus TDS, then you will get your output. In Laplace transform is like this. Okay, this is the block diagram. I need to revisit this slide again to correct the misplace of this formula back into the box. Sorry for this, guys. If we do it in the first order system, the transfer function will be this. Okay, for the dead time, we have the correlations between the output from the dead time transfer function with respect to the output of the system is equal to this. Okay, therefore the transfer function between the input and the delayed output is given by the multiplications of the first order system with the dead time in here. If we put the same analogy into the second order system, then we can recover this one in the bottom in here. Okay, these are the examples of the response of the time delay system to step input change. So this is for the first order, the one on the left hand side. This is the one for the second order systems on the right hand side in here. Okay, then next one we talk about is the inverse response processes. The inverse response processes can be identified either from their step response or from their transfer function. If we do it from the step response, then they will have an opposite initial response to their final value. If we have these things, the typical response, then the resultant inverse response will be like this. Okay. From the transfer function, then they will have a positive zeros. For example, if you identify the inverse response processes from the transfer function below, if you ask these things in here, how we do these things, we have three different transfer functions. Okay, we find out that the zero of the G1S is 1/5. Okay, what the functions that make this, the S that makes the numerator become zero. Okay, so that one is called zero, which is positive. Okay, this one is an inverse response process. Okay, because it has zeros. This G2 in here, you cannot make the numerator cannot be made into a zero. That's why this is not an inverse response process. Okay, the third one in here also have a zero, because If you put in s equal 1 minus 1/3 in here, then this is but this is not positive. Okay, this is negative 1/3. So if you put in s equal negative 1/3, then you will make the numerator become zero. But this is not an inverse process because the s is not equal to positive. It's not positive. It's negative value. Okay, so these are how you find the inverse response from the transfer function if they have positive zeros. You remember back again into your I think if not wrong week 4 or week 5, the one on the numerator in here is called zeros. The one on the denominator in here is called poles. Okay, the value of your poles in here, whether they are negative or they are positive, that will determine whether your system is stable or not. Okay, if you go back into your previous lectures. In here, on the other hand, the values of the zeros in here will determine your whether you have the inverse response processes or not. Okay. These are the example. For example, the inverse response process. So anybody has questions up to this particular point that we cover the theory of the first order, the theory of the second order. Guys, anybody, any questions? Alvin, Amanda, Clarence, Daniel, James, Jason, Jonathan, Juliana, Cising, Michael, Taha, Rachel, Selena, Tiffany, Yusi, Mongyo, Weixing. Everything looks simple, right? And when you go into the concepts in here, right? It's not something that are easy, but the impression with the concept given in here is a bit different, right? Actually, if you just go with the simple concept in terms of the linear control theory, where you just put in the Laplace transform, where you just put in the easy stability, when you just play with the linear ordinary differential equation, then it's easy. But this theory, actually, if you want to do the real plain white process control, then it's just not sufficient for you. That's why we give you Aspen Plus components into your tutorial in order for you to be able to try to simulate some simple processes in terms of the plain white control. Okay, so if there's no questions from you guys, then I will continue with my week 6 so that we can go a bit ahead of the time. I still have another material that I will discuss on the week 6. That one is on the advanced control. Okay, the advanced control, I put it as the second set of the material for the week 6 to for you to be able to understand a little bit on how did they do the advanced control in the industry. Okay, so feedback control is basically the crux of the process control. So everything that you put into the control structure, they must come from the feedback control. Okay, the feedback control is very important. Then you can add on. You can add on extra component. You can add on a feed forward control. You can add on something like a different, like a cascade control. Or you can add on like override control, for example. You can add on another different types of the control that will make the dynamic controllability of the systems becomes better. But feedback control is the main component of your control. You have to have that feedback control first in order for you to be able to judge the effectiveness of your control, of the other control. Okay, so at the end of this lecture, you should be able to explain the typical feedback control system in chemical processes, okay? And what are the different types of the feedback controllers, advantages and disadvantages of each controller type. Select the most appropriate controller type for the desired control response. Remember, we go back again into our discussions, and this is never enough. We still gonna be iterating this feedback control again. Okay, the feedback control is used is applied by you. You have the disturbance, right? You have the manipulated variables. You have the control variable. If you use the control, whatever the control variable is, has to be measured. Okay. Then once it is measured, then it will be connected to the controller that will adjust the value of the manipulated variable to control the control variables. So if you go back into your project one, your disturbance will be the feed flow rate to the reactor. That can be, of course, can be changed, but for the sake of your project one, we will not bother to change the disturbance. Okay, your control variable is the temperature of the reactor. If you ask me for project one, Jaka, why you decide to control the temperature of the reactor? Because the temperature of the reactor is the heart of the reactor. If you have an exothermic reaction, if the temperature is not controlled, you will have a safety problem. It's not just maintaining. It's not just about optimizing the product on the performance of your reaction, but it's also controlling the safety of the system. So that's why it's very important that the temperature of the reactor is controlled first. That's why it is the control variable. Okay, and then you control the reactor temperature using, in this particular case for the project one, you use the heat that are put into the reactor. Okay, in terms of the cooling of the reactor, then the manipulated variable will be the flow rate of the coolant through your jacket. That will be your manipulated variables. So everything in the control system is starting from this particular point. You need to understand the disturbance. You need to understand the manipulated variable, and then you need to understand the control variables. Okay, and you need to if you go back into your later, if you design your plan, you need to know what kind of disturbance is coming into your unit. Is it the flow rate? Is it the composition disturbance that come into these things? Then you simulate the maximum value of the disturbance into your system to check whether whatever you put into your control systems can make sure that the system's output will be within the range that can be tolerated. So these are the block diagram of the typical open loop. When we mean an open loop is that we do not control the process at all. The process just behave as they are. We don't put any control loop. That's called an open loop process. In here, we put M for the manipulated variable, D for the disturbance, Y for the output variables. We can express this in terms of the stir tank heater open loop system as an analogy or as an illustration. So we have a flow in, temperature in, we have a flow out, temperature out, we have a steering in here, we have the temperature, and then we have a flow rate of the steam. Okay, and then we also have a heat that goes into our stir tank heater open loop system. In the feedback control loop, we are introducing a component, a measurement component. Okay, the temperature in here is measured. So what we control in here is in essence the temperature of the liquid within your tank, right? Then we want to keep it at a set point in here, and we put the error into the controller to adjust the flow rate of the steam that goes into your system. So this flow rate of the steam will basically regulate the Q that comes into your stir tank. If we draw it in terms of the block diagram that you people normally use in the process control, it will be like this. Okay, M come from him, is manipulated. This is the disturbance. You have the outlet. This output is introduced into the measuring device. Then what you get from the measuring device is called YM. Okay, and then you find the error between the YM and YSP. That's why this one is put in terms of the minus. Guys, this is very important, okay? This is minus, this is plus. Then the difference between the YSP and the YM goes into the controller. The controller output will be called C. This C will determine the manipulated variable. Okay, this is very important. Closed loop feedback control system diagram in here. So, what are the examples? So, these are some of the examples of the typical feedback control systems. Okay, the flow control in the pipeline. So, you measure the using a differential pressure cell. What is the flow rate? Then, you adjust it by closing or opening the valve of your that is connected with the pipe in here. Okay, this is typical for this flow control. These are the liquid level control at the bottom of distillation column. So you have the differential pressure cell that measure the height of the liquid. Okay, then this will go to the controller. This controller will regulate the outlet that comes out from this from the bottom of the distillation column. The pressure control in here, you have a differential pressure cell that measure the pressure on your tank. Okay, if the pressure is much larger than what you want it to be, then you can increase the flow outlet from this tank, the output stream from this particular tank. Okay, the temperature control in here is work in a similar way with what you will do in your laboratory, basically. Okay, we are based on the temp. This the temperature of the stream that comes out from this heat exchanger is the one that you want to control. Okay, that's why you put in into the thermocouple. This is the set point. The controller will adjust the flow rate of the heater that goes into your into exchange with your stream that you control in here. Okay, these are similar. You just need to understand the principle. And this is the composition control. The composition control in here is basically adjusting the measuring the compositions of the mixture that comes from the mixing of F1 and F2. It uses a chromatograph, and then it adjusts the flow rate of the stream number one in here. This composition control is actually not very common in industry, guys, because the chromatograph is quite expensive to operate. Okay, so normally if in the place of the composition control, except for a very expensive product, I think that that requires a very highly accurate composition quality control, then most of the time people will use an inferential control. For example, in a distillation column, instead of using a composition control to check the composition or the concentration of your reflux or your top product, you can use a temperature from the two or three trays as an indirect measurement for your compositions of the distilled product. Okay, but in here anyway, we just give you some kind of example. Then you can make it much more simple with the mechanisms. This is what you need to do. You put in the DP. This is the one that is complete that we showed you earlier. What you can do is basically you can replace this by the FT, flow transmitter, flow controller. You put in this dash dash to show the signal flow. Okay, and then you put in this valve again in here. Same thing, this one again with the feedback liquid level control. You can simply put the liquid transmitter, which is connected to the liquid control, to the level transmitter with the level controller, not liquid transmitter, level controller. In reality, you cannot put in, you cannot separate the integral or the derivative. So you have three types of the component: proportional controller, proportional integral controller, and proportional integral derivative controller. Okay, when we talk about the controller, then the controller output, which is defined as the deviation variable, is proportional to the error signal for proportional or P controller. You may ask me again at this particular point of time, where is that C coming back again, sir? You go back again into this diagram. Okay. Whatever the error that comes in here, this will have a relationship with the C that comes out from your controller, depending whether you are using a proportional integral, or proportional derivative controller. Okay. These are the one that I skip. I think I skip earlier. Okay. You can simplify the presentation of feedback control systems by using a diagrammatic, by replace the diagrammatic detail with this circle, simple circle, in terms of the control, flow control, pressure control, liquid level, temperature control, or composition control. Okay, or you can also use a square or circle where representing the measurement and transmission of the liquid level, temperature, pressure, flow, and concentration. Okay, for proportional control, whatever that comes out from your controller will be proportional with the error. Okay, and proportional controller is defined by the two by one constant called Kc. So this PB, it can also be defined by the proportional band, but proportional band is the same with the Kc. Okay. Where in fact this proportional band is just 100 divided by Kc. So if you do a Laplace transform into this proportional controller, you will get that your transfer function is equal to the Kc. This is what happens with the proportional controller when you introduce a step change. Okay, if you introduce step change, it will change into and it will go and change, and then eventually it will reach a plateau. If you increase the Kc, then the difference between the new steady state with your old steady state will be less, will be reduced. Okay, I remember that one group get this project in the process modeling. So you those for those group you can use this slides to understand a bit more. But you need to be careful because as you increase the Kc in here, even though you decrease the offset, you compromise, you are trading it off with the stability of the system, because you can see that this start on fluctuating in here, start on oscillating. So it's very important that we know that the offset will be reduced with increasing the Kc, but the system may oscillate. The advantage of the proportional controller is that it is easy to tune because only a single parameter that is present in the system, which is Kc. The problem is that it cannot eliminate an offset. So proportional controller is normally attractive for applications where deviation from the steady state can be tolerated. Okay, for example, in the liquid level control. I want to go back again into your system in the second. In the second. Okay. When we talk about the systems in here, okay, we have only one tank that we put in the proportional integral controller. So if we put a proportional integral controller into this system, we'll basically adjusting this outlet stream such that we recover back the steady state liquid level system. For one tank, it will be okay, but if you put in this proportional integral controller into two or three tanks in series, you will have a problem. Okay, because you will have a propagations of the adjustment, because whatever the effect of the adjustment that you make from one system, it will be imparted into the other system. And because you have the system in series, that propagation will be magnified. So you will have a difficult system to manage if you put in this proportional integral controller. I will not go and discuss these things in detail, but you can go into the Louis Benz book or a paper. He has described these things and simulate that thing into the Aspen Plus dynamics. But for the liquid level, I have to tell you that the best practice to do is that you just stick with the proportional only controller. except if you are dealing with a special case such as reactor, where you need to maintain that liquid level at the exact same point to maintain the production rate or the reaction performance. Okay, so you need to go back into my slides, previous slide, that where I told you a basic on the Prandtl-White process control. You need to be aware of the snowball effect as well. If you have a snowball effect, that means you cannot just simply put in. You need to use a flow control to somewhere along your recycle line. The proportional integral controller in here is also called as a proportional plus reset controller. So this equation in here shows you the controller output relationship with respect to the error. Okay, if you use a transform function, you use a Laplace transform, you will get these particular equations in here. Okay, why do you call it as a reset? Anybody knows? You see, Alvin, Taha, why we call it a reset in here? Because we have a second parameter in here, which we call the reset time. Okay, the reset time in here is varies in the range of 0.1 to 50 minutes. These are the typical response of the proportional integral controller. If you leave it open, it will be like this. Let's say you keep the reset time fixed and you increase the Kc, you see that it becomes unstable in here. Okay, so this one, you know that this one is a function of the Kc at a fixed Ti value for a step change. So we want to be a bit careful on these things. In here, instead, we are showing you the closed loop response of proportional integral control as a function of the Ti value at a fixed Kc value for a step change. So when we increase the reset time, it means it seems that we are getting a more stable system in here. Okay, therefore the precaution that we need to be to put in mind is that we don't want to use a very small values of the integral time or the reset time, because we may make it unstable in some value. I mean, you can make it like this: how fast do you want your reset time is how fast you want your system to go back into the steady state value. Okay, that is what is meant by the reset time. You don't want that reset time to be so fast, to be when you put a very small value, meaning you make it, you want to make it very very fast to go back into the steady state value. You don't want to give it a proportional a good time for the systems to go back into, for your controller to make it adjust your system to go back into the steady state. Okay, so you go back again into this to look at it. Okay, the advantage is that the offset can be eliminated, so you will recover back your steady state. Okay, however, the tuning is hard because two parameters must be specified. The bad tuning may lead to instability given the oscillation behavior of the proportional integral controller. Okay, we come with the next one, the last one, the proportional integral derivative controller. Okay, proportional integral derivative is called proportional plus reset plus rate controller. So we have the other terms in here that basically use the derivative of the error in here. So we are dealing with essentially three parameters in here. The last one is the so-called derivative time. If we use the Laplace transform into the equation 5, we will recover this equation 6 in here. Okay. You will ask why we bother to use a derivative controller, sir, to put in into why the PI is not enough. Because actually, if you put in you add in the derivative, it will smooth out the controllability of the proportional integral derivative, because it will make the dynamic controllability becomes better. Okay, this is because the last component, the third component in here, applies a control action which is proportional to the current rate of change in the error. So it's basically adding the anticipatory control into your control system, into your feedback control system. So this one is not feed forward, okay? Because if feed forward, meaning you are measuring the disturbance to control the manipulated variables. But in here is not. It's basically you are still using a feedback, but you basically learn from the trend of your error, use that to anticipate what the future error will be. The major drawback of this PID controller is if you have a response with the constant non-zero error. So for example, if there is a constant non-zero error, for example, if the error keep on having a value of one, okay, then your slope will be equal to zero, right? Imagine if your error keep is stay constant at a value of one, then your slope will be zero, basically, okay. And if you have another one, it's the noisy response with almost zero error. It may compute a large derivative and thus yield a large control action, although it may not be needed in the real situation. This is the performance of the PID control to step change. Okay, if we increase the TD, we basically increase the oscillation. This will be a function of the TD at the fixed KC and the fixed derivative value. Oh, I think I need to fix this thing. This is supposed to be TI. Guys, I think I make a mistake. I make mistakes in here. Or this one is actually assuming the value of the TI is also the same as well. Okay, so the advantage is that the oscillation can be dampened with respect to proportional integral control. However, the tuning will be harder than proportional integral controllers since three parameters must be specified. Then we go into the rough rule of thumb for using the three controllers. You want to use the P controller only when the steady state offset can be tolerated. Okay, most of the cases there will be a liquid level controller. You just want to make sure that the tank are not dry, okay? They don't dry or they don't spill, okay? Proportional integral controller when offset cannot be tolerated. So most of your feedback control loop in the typical plan will be your PI controller. If it is very important to compensate some natural sluggishness in the system, then you may want to use a proportional integral derivative controller. This will give you a typical response of a feedback system. No control, proportional control, when you apply a PI, when you apply a PID. You can see that the PID is better, much more smooth. Okay. And PI, it will slowly go back into your original steady state value. In your project one, however, you see that you have three variables. You have a temperature of the jacket, you have the temperature of the reactor, and you have the concentration of your reactant. The thing that you control is the temperature of the reactor. So your temperature of the reactor will go back into your steady state. But it does not mean that your concentration of the reactant and your temperature of the jacket will go back into the original steady state value. Right, guys? Did you notice that in your project one? This will be what you will get from from this week's session. Okay, this is the so-called multi-processes bench. So when you do your liquid level controller, you basically gonna see the liquid level in here. Okay, if when you do your temperature control, you will use this EE1, this component, because it will have that exchanger element that is the same that we show in the previous slide. Okay, and you will also have a flow control as well, a flow control that basically adjusted by this valve in here. Okay, you have this valve 4 and valve 7 that will adjust your flow. These are the simulating example that I don't really use into my process control, because I think Simulink is too simple. It doesn't really give you the tools to simulate the system. Rather, I give you MATLAB, a simple MATLAB in your project one, for you to have an insight into how all the mathematical models are simulated into the coding, so that you can see that everything is not just in terms of the black box. You put in things, you will get out something, but you don't know what happening inside. That's MATLAB code is given for you to be able to understand what actually happens. It's not necessary for you to try to understand the whole MATLAB code, but at least you know that this is needed. You need to specify this, and then you need to do this looping is needed for this, and how did you embed your proportional control, integral control, okay? And lastly, the Aspen Plus Dynamics is the tools that you need to put in case later on some of you decided to go into the process control research, or in case in the future, for example, some of you is asked by your clients to design a control structure that can maintain the disturbance, or in case some of you is asked to do a process design to make a reactor or something. And like I told you in the beginning, you have to start with the end in mind. So not just dealing with the steady state aspect, but you also need to deal with the dynamic aspect of your process to make sure that whatever you design can be easily controlled. Okay, and these are the characteristics of the PID controller. So it produces an offset, increasing KC reduces the offset, but may lead to oscillations. The proportional integral control will eliminate the offset. The proportional integral derivative control will dampen the oscillation caused by the integral action. So I think that will be all for today's lecture. I think I have been talking for about 1 hour because I finished the week five, the remaining of the week five, and the first part of the lecture for the week six. So I think tomorrow's lecture we will have no lecture for tomorrow's session, but I will basically welcome everybody. If they want to come, I will show up in my, I will still show up at 1 o'clock. Tomorrow is what? Tomorrow should be 1 p.m. I think tomorrow is process control, right? Tomorrow is process control, if I'm wrong. 1 p.m. 1 p.m. for tomorrow is 1 p.m. right, guys? Tomorrow is 1 p.m. or 12 p.m. For the process control. Tomorrow is 1 p.m. right? For the process control. So tomorrow's lecture we will not have a tomorrow's 12 p.m. Tomorrow. Really? You see? I forgot. Tomorrow is 1 or 12 p.m. 12 until 1? Oh, 12 until 1, so 1 p.m. Okay. We will not have a lecture at 12 again, but rather I will still show up, and any of you can show up if you have and if you want any consultations on your project, okay? You can ask anything that you want. In either on the process modeling or the process control. Okay, so we will go with this kind of pace, so to make it a bit more affordable for you to do your project. Okay, if there is no more questions, then that will be all for today. Any questions? Alvin, Amanda, Clarence, Daniel, James, Jason, Jonathan, Juliana, Chising, Michael, Taha, Rachel, Selena, Tiffany, you see, Wong Yo, Weixing, or you probably already gone a while ago because my lecture is too sleepy. It makes it too technical. No? Okay, if no questions, then I will just download my attendance list first to put up the attendance into my into the Campus Nexus, and then I will stop the recording here.